He does have a face after all. We have gotten word this week that so long as I maintain 15 feet of distance between me and you, and that so long as our building meets certain requirements, and so long as I am fully vaccinated with 2 weeks after my second shot, I can take off my mask now during the sermon only. Oh, yeah. So all the people that have complained how muffled I sound, well, now I have no excuse. So I'm thrilled. Changes, more changes are coming. Beginning next week, there will be some limited ability to have congregational singing back with us. So this pandemic is working its way out. And we're not out of the woods yet, but we are on our way. And we can see light at the end of the tunnel, we hope. And so just keep your fingers crossed that we go forward instead of taking a step back. People have been somewhat critical of the Episcopal Church because we've been so careful. And I'm quick to point out that we have not had any of the spreader events that have been in some other churches and denominations. So I think there's wisdom in being careful. As I read the gospel for today, it struck me how many times the gospel lesson uses the idea that Jesus both protects us and prays to his Father for our protection. I say that Jesus prays for our protection because he prays for his disciples, those who are his followers, and from the very first 12 apostles all the way to all Christians today, we all fall into that category as his followers. Look at the lesson. Holy Father, protect them in your name that you have given me. While I was with them, I protected them, I guarded them. I have given them your word. I am not asking you to take them out of the world, but I ask you to protect them. Do you get the idea that Jesus is trying to protect us? He is. And so today, I want us to look at the protection of Jesus. What does it mean to be protected in the name of Jesus? Some years ago, I saw a program on PBS. I think it was an episode of NOVA. At any rate, the program was all about comets and asteroids and meteors slamming into planets and slamming into their moons. Some years ago, an astronomer plotted the path of a string of small comets that were hurling through space, and that string of small comets crashed into Jupiter, attracted by its massive gravitational pull. The program showed photographs of the impact from the Hubble, taken from the Hubble telescope of that crash, leaving huge scars on the planet Jupiter, scars which the program quickly pointed out were about the same size as the entire planet Earth. Huge scars. We think of comets and meteors as something beautiful to watch in the night sky as they fly across. They show, the show that I saw pointed to the pockmarked surface of the moon, like the Earth with the terrible case of acne. All the huge craters and holes give every indication that they are not volcanic, as I had been taught when I was a student in the Dark Ages, but rather caused by something that like an astronomical car crash that slammed into them on scales we can't begin to imagine. And then they told about discovering similar crashes on Earth, one on the eastern edges of Russia and Siberia in the early part of the 20th century, and another crash which perhaps was the cataclysmic cause of the Gulf of Mexico and the end of the dinosaurs. The show ended with a discussion of plans for something like Star Wars, the strategic defense initiative of many years ago, except retooled to blow up meteors and asteroids and comets before they could hit the Earth. And of course, that got me to think about the scientific marker that stands at the boardwalk in Cape Charles on the eastern shore where my sister lives. Cape Charles is near the epicenter of a great meteor crash about 35 million years ago, at the mouth of what is now the Chesapeake Bay. According to the U.S. Geological Survey website, the crater looks sort of like an upside-down sombrero with the center right about where Cape Charles is. The 96-mile-wide crater goes as far northwest as most of Matthews County. It includes parts of Newport News and the Virginia mainland, so it stretches all the way across the bay. The impact has smashed and messed up the underground water aquifers of both Cape Charles and Newport News, which my sister is reminded every month by her minimum $118 water bill for Cape Charles, because they really have to go deep to find water that is not infiltrated by salt. I remember that as I watched that television show, I began to get a sense of impending doom. Being only slightly paranoid, I remember thinking when I went to bed that night that there might be a meteor or comet with my name on it, just zooming around and ready to crash through the bedroom window. At first, I thought I was just being silly, but then it dawned on me that generally we take the protection of God for granted. St. Julian of Norwich was a mystic. She was a recluse who lived in the 14th century. She had divine revelations and received meditations which she shared. And the amazing thing is a 14th century woman is still published today. How about them apples? You know, you can still buy her book, Divine Revelations. These revelations made theological history because she expresses profound thought in the simplest of language. One of the revelations she received, she describes as follows. She said, "And Jesus showed me more, a little thing, the size of a hazelnut, on the palm of my hand, round like a ball. I looked at it thoughtfully and wondered, what is this? And the answer came, it is everything that is made. I marveled that it continued to exist and did not suddenly disintegrate, it was so small. Again, my mind supplied the answer, it exists both now and forever because God loves it." Think about it. In short, everything owes its existence to the love of God, and that is the protection of God. Everything that exists continues to exist because God loved it into existence, and God loves it enough to keep it around. We think of the earth as permanent and solid and indestructible, and in reality, it is as precarious as those little man-made particles that we can create for only tiny fractions of a second before they fall apart. It is as unstable as the quicksand, and it is fragile as those azaleas on the front of the church that a couple of weeks ago were just blooming like crazy, and now they're just the wilted remains of what was. But it is guarded, protected, and held in existence by the strongest power that exists, the unconditional love of God. And beyond the protection which God gives to the entire universe, God gives even more protection for us. What Jesus guards and protects us doesn't transport us into vacuum-sealed glass cases in a celestial museum. No, we're left squarely in the world, subject to exactly the same parables as the rest of the universe, petroleum pipelines and all. We are protected instead from the evil one. Jesus says this to his first disciples. "I guarded them, and not one of them was lost except the one destined to be lost so that Scripture might be fulfilled." Literally, Jesus said he kept them safe. He kept watch over them like one would guard a treasure. "So that not one of them was lost." Literally, not one of them perished. Remember, God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, that all who believe in him may not perish but have eternal life. "Except the one destined to be lost." Literally, in Greek, he says the son of perdition means the son of damnation, the one who already belongs to the evil one, which is the Aramaic
saying the Antichrist. So notice that in the Gospel according to John, the Antichrist comes not at the end of time, but rather during the ministry of Jesus on earth before he returns to the Father. My point is this. Through his protection, we followers of Jesus are not protected from the trials and tribulations of this world. Instead, what we are protected from is the evil one. In fact, the Lord's Prayer out of the Gospel according to Matthew, when we pray, deliver us from evil, Matthew uses the same word as John does there, poneros. And so, we do not pray to be delivered from some generalized, disembodied concept of bad things. Instead, we pray to be saved from the evil one, the source, personification, and concentration of all hatred and sin. And notice how that protection is accomplished. By sanctification or consecration, Jesus prays, sanctify them in the truth. Your word is truth. Literally, to sanctify something means to make it holy, to set it apart for God's holy use, and to keep it from being contaminated from sin and disease. Jesus says, I have given them your word. Now, those of you who know me, and for those of you who know the Gospel according to John, you know that the correct pronoun for the word of God is not it. The correct pronoun for the word of God is not what? We're not talking about the scriptures here being the word of God. We're talking, as John begins his gospel, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. And so when Jesus says, I have given them your Word, he's really saying, I've given them myself, your Son, the second person of the Trinity, God in the flesh. So here comes the point. When we are baptized in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, we are set apart for God's use. We are consecrated, sanctified, and sealed by the Holy Spirit in baptism, and marked as Christ's own forever. And at that moment, we are protected, guarded, set apart from the evil of this world, and given the Word of God, the presence of Jesus in the form of the Spirit. We are protected in the name which God gave to the only begotten, Yeshua, Jesus, Joshua, which means God saves. By the way, that means that all those signs by the highway that says Jesus saves are redundant. They are, because literally Jesus means God saves, so they all say God saves, saves. So what are you going to do? We are protected in our baptisms not because we're good, not because we earn it, not because we deserve to be protected. We're protected because we bear the name and spirit of the crucified, resurrected, and ascended Lord of life as a gift from God. Because God has marked us and identified us forever as children of the resurrection. Amen. Now, since I have quit preaching, I have to go.